Okay, the subject is counting statistics in multiple puzzle geometries and quantum steering. As you see from the title, the main issue here is the topology, which is the essence of Aharonov-Bohm physics. Contrary to the prevailing literature about counting statistics, we are not interested here in open geometries with leads and reservoirs. Rather, we are interested in a closed system. And if you are looking for non-trivial topology in a closed system, then obviously the simplest system would be a ring, and the simplest ring would be a three-side system. So the Hamiltonian matrix is 3x3. The work has been done with my student, Maya Hochem. There is, in parallel, some further work about quantum steering in conventional ring, by my student Marcella, but I will not talk about it. So, first we shall consider the simplest problem, which is just two sides. We place here a particle in the left side with very low potential energy. Then we raise the potential energy, and the particle will go from the left to the right. And we measure, so to say, the current through this bond, and we define the counting operator as the integral over the current, and we ask what is the expectation value of the counting operator and what is the variance. So this would be single path coherent transition. Then we shall go to the system of interest. We raise the potential, the particle goes from left to right, but now it can go either this way or this way, and we measure the current here and define the counting operator and ask the same question. And then, really, we are interested in quantum steering, which means by periodically changing the potential, we want to induce a circulating current, and the simplest way to do it is as follows. We raise here the potential, the particle go from left to right, but what we do is we block this bond, so the current flows through this bond. Then in the second half of the cycle, we lower the potential. The particle will go back from right to left. But now we block this bond, open this bond, so the current goes through here. So by doing this repeatedly, we should get a circulating current, and we ask per cycle, what is the expectation value and the variance of the counting operator? And I will not have the time, but we also can ask what happens with this quantum steering process when we have not one particle, but many particles, and they are interacting. Okay, so that's the outline. First, I have to say one remark about Q, the counting operator. It is not really an observable. It is not something that you can measure. What you can do is a weak continuous measurement during which the current is coupled to some von Neumann pointer, and this von Neumann pointer is displaced, and you look at this von Neumann pointer at the end of the time, and then you see that the state of the von Neumann pointer is described by some quasi-distribution, and what people call full quantum statistics, full counting statistics, is the various moments of this object. But you can forget about this story of full counting statistics because I'm interested just in the first and second moments of the full counting statistics, and you can easily see that these are given simply as the expectation value of the counting operator. So if you want to more about full counting statistics for this system, then we have some publication about it, but I will not discuss it. So I'm interested just in the average and in the variance, and the way to do calculation is simply to calculate the counting operator and to take the expectation value and to tell you what is the result. So let's see what the results that come out from such calculation. Yeah, I can.
Are we supposed to understand this?
No. All I say is, All I say is those who are familiar with full counting statistics since will ask me how can it be or something, so this is an answer for the experts. That's standard definition, I can expand on it later, but really what I'm going to do now is to calculate expectation value of the counting operator, which is defined as the integral over the current operator, and this is the only thing which is important for this presentation. So let's see what comes out from such calculation. So the simplest model is this two-side system. We raise the potential, the particle goes from left to right with some probability P. This probability P is actually the probability to be to stay at the lower adiabatic level. This is so-called Landau-Zener transitions. This is the energy of this side. This is the energy of this side. And at some point, the particle will go from left to right. And the probability can be calculated using the Landau-Zener formula. Now we ask about the counting. So the simplest naive reasoning is as follows. One possibility that has probability P is that the particle will occupy at the end the right side. So this has some probability P. And then we say, okay, so the counting will be one. We should count one particle going from left to right. The other possibility is that the particle will stay left. This has probability 1 minus p, so the final occupation of the right side will be 0, and the counting will be 0 because the particle didn't go through this section. So if this, so according to this reasoning, the counting on the average will be p, and the variance will be 1 minus p times p. Okay, there is only one problem with this type of reasoning. In the quantum mechanical calculation, you should remember that you will, one can easily see that the counting operator and the occupation operator do not commute. And in fact, if you calculate the eigenvalues of Q, these are not 1 and 0, but plus or minus square root of P with some probabilities. But miraculously, when you calculate the first and the second moment, you find out that it is like in the classical reasoning. Yeah. The reason that Q is plus minus something is simply because the trace of Q is zero, because the trace of the current operator is zero. Oh, anyway, so you do the proper calculation, and for some mysterious reason, it comes out like the naive expectation. So you ask yourself, what is the reason for this? And immediately you realize that the rate of change of the occupation is equal to the current, and therefore the change in the occupation equal to the counting. This is the continuity equation. But these three are operators, and they do not commute. So it is, in a sense, non-trivial relation. Now, you can take the expectation value of two sides, and you conclude that as far as the first and second moments are concerned, the occupation, the counting statistics is exactly like the occupation statistics. So the first and second moments for the counting operator should be the same as the first and second moment of the occupation operator, and for this reason, we got the same result. And this we call restricted quantum classical correspondence because it relates only to the first two moments, not to the higher moments of the counting statistics, but now you immediately realize that there is an issue here. And the issue is that this type of argument applies only when you have simple topology and cannot be generalized when you have multiple paths topology. So once we have multiple path topology, we expect something more interesting. So let's see what happens if the particle has two ways to go from left to right. So you raise here the potential, the particle goes from left to right with some probability P that can be calculated using the Landau-Zener formula. But now, since it has two ways to go, then you will say that there is some fraction lambda here which multiplies P, which is natural to call this fraction the splitting ratio. So some fraction of the probability goes through this bond. so the question is, what is this fraction? Now, classically, you will think that this fraction should be the coupling square here divided by the sum of these two coupling squares, which is a number between 0 and 1. This is something that you would guess on the basis of maybe, I don't know, Fermi golden rule considerations or something like this. But of course, this formula is not correct. If you do the calculation, you will get something else, which is written here. And the puzzling thing about this splitting ratio is that since it involves here amplitudes, it doesn't have to be a number between 0 and 1. It can be larger than 1 or negative, depending on the relative sign of C1 and C2. And this is the place where Aharonov-Bohm physics enters, because this relative sign is, so to say, the interference within the ring, which can come with a plus or minus sign. So one thing that I will have to explain, how can it be that the splitting ratio can be a number which is not between 0 and 1? The other thing is about the result for the variance. Well, as the particle goes from left to right, what we have here, so to say, is a current which is partitioned into two paths. So you are used to think that if you partition a current, then you have, as a result, a noisy current here in this bond. So you would expect that even if it is a strictly adiabatic process, where P equals 1, the particle goes fully to the right side, you expect that because of the splitting, you will have some noise. But lambda doesn't multiply P in the actual calculation. If you do the actual calculation, you will find that it multiplies the 1 minus P times P from the outside, which means that if the process is strictly adiabatic, then in spite of this partitioning, the splitting process is actually noiseless. Therefore, I'm not using the term partitioning, I'm using the term splitting. So splitting is a noiseless process. So also this point I have to explain you intuitively. So in a moment I will explain what is the difference between splitting and partitioning, and also I will explain why the splitting ratio is not necessarily a number between 0 and 1. But before I go to this heuristic explanation, I would like to give you the last set of results, which was the motivation for getting into this calculation. And the last set of results is when you do a full quantum steering cycle. So in a full quantum steering cycle, you raise the potential, the particle goes from left to right, and then you lower the potential here, and the particle goes back from right to left. So if it is strictly adiabatic, there is no remnant of the particle in the right side, and then it is, and then the occupation of the right side at the end will be zero. But if it is not strictly adiabatic, then you will have some remnant of the particle in the right side, and it is a conventional calculation to see how much is left in the right side. There is some interference here because we have two Landau-Zener transitions. Okay, this is standard, but we are interested in the counting. So what about the counting? So even, let's say that the process is adiabatic, then the particle goes from left to right and then back from right to left. If the splitting ratio in the way from left to right and in the way from right to left is not the same number, then obviously we will have some net counting here. So this formula is actually a formula for the amount of charge, amount of particles which is pumped per cycle. Now, originally, actually, this result, I derived it long ago using conventional formalism, following Taule, Savron, Berry, Robbins. There is a standard adiabatic transport formalism. You can calculate the Kubo curvature. You can do some calculation. It is definitely not undergraduate exercise, I would say, but you get this result. What is nice about this work, that we managed to get this result in one-page calculation that actually any undergraduate student can understand. So we bypassed this Kubo. And I would like also to make a remark that independently, in parallel, there was a work by Saarav, Joel Horowitz, and Chris Dzerzhinsky, where they considered stochastic steering, and actually they used a different, similar philosophy. They called it current decomposition formula. So this is a nice point of view, this splitting issue, and allows you very easily to calculate the amount of pumping per cycle. And now what about the variance? So really what we wanted to do is to calculate the variance, and you see that also in this result there is some interference going on, but it is different from what you see here. You see that there is no obvious or simple relation between the counting statistics, let's call it, and the occupation statistics. Okay, I guess we can spend more time on this transparency, but since time is ending, I will do two things. One thing is to, I owe you a heuristic explanation about splitting versus partitioning. Now, why you are used to the idea that partitioning leads to noise? This is because when you have this von Neumann pointer, then in the Schrödinger cat paradigm, let's call it, it gets entangled with the state of the system. So you measure, so it will have displacement either 0 or 1. So the final state of the pointer is a mixture, and this means noise. So this is what happens when you have partitioning of the current. But we are talking about a closed system, and we are talking about an adiabatic process. And then you have a different paradigm, which is the Born-Oppenheimer paradigm. And according to this paradigm, the state of the system is protected. So the state of the pointer remains pure, and in fact what the pointer is measuring is, say, half particle. Let's say that it is 50-50 splitting. Then what the pointer is measuring is, so to say, half particle, and it is a noiseless process. So this answers why splitting and partitioning is not the same. Okay. The other question that you can ask is, how can it be that, say, 400% of the particle go one way and minus 300% of the particle go another way? The sum is, of course, 100%. The particle goes from left to right. But how can it be that it is not something like that, but 400%, say, and minus 300%? And the answer here is actually very simple. We are dealing with a closed system. When you change a parameter in the Hamiltonian, you induce a circulating current. Now, think about the circulating current in classical terms. So the particle is doing several rounds and end up at the right side. So if you count here, you do the counting here, you will count 4. And if you do the counting here, you will count minus 3. The sum is 1, but the splitting is not a fraction between 0 and 1. So these are the two intuitive explanations. Few words about the calculation. Originally, we tried to do a brute force calculation of the counting operator, taking expectation values, doing contour integrals in order to calculate what we wanted to calculate. But eventually, we realized that there is a way to do exact calculations simply by reducing the three-site problem to a two-site problem. And then the splitting ratio appears in this reduction as a factor that multiplies the current operator. So, of course, I have no time to get into this transparency, though it is very simple. Also, you can ask about the long time counting statistics if we are doing many, many, many cycles of steering. I will jump over this. And also, of course, you can ask what happens if there are interactions. And just in one word, once you have many particles condensed in these levels, then you should distinguish, depending on the size and the sign of the interaction between what we call classical ball dynamics, mega crossing, gradual crossing, sequential crossings. So there is a lot of fun with this steering issue, The references for this presentation, these are the two works with my students Maya Chuchem, and I told you that there is about steering also in a conventional ring, a work with Itamar Sela, and the BEC stuff is mainly collaboration with some Pico Scotos and his student and another postdoc. So main messages are as follows. Well, for some reason, no one bothered to do full counting statistic analysis of the simplest system, which is a two-site coherent transition. So there is, was some gap that we were happy to fill, so to say. I didn't talk about it. Then we've turned to what really interested us, which is the three-site system, where you have multiple path geometry, where a quantum classical correspondence fails. And we distinguish between coherent splitting and incoherent partitioning of current in such process, and using splitting ratio approach rather than Kubo, we were able to do the calculation in a very simple way that any undergraduate student can understand. What really interested us was how the interference show up in this calculation of the counting statistics, and there is some discussion that I didn't do about exact versus adiabatic results for the counting statistics and about long time counting statistics. And there is some issue of interactions, which is interesting by itself. And thank you very much for your attention. Actually, we discussed once in Prague this point. I don't want to really to get too much into it, but I have used here the definition of Nazarov, as you noticed, for the full counting statistic kernel. So to the extent that you agree or not agree with Nazarov, that's what was the framework that I was using. So in this aspect, I didn't do any change. I mean, just considering a simpler system. He, for some reason, considered a very complicated oscillator, harmonic oscillator model for which he was not able to do exact calculation. With two sites or three sites, you can do exact calculation with his formula, his definition of counting statistics following Levitov.